This Week at NASA. NASA commercial partner SpaceX is a step closer on its planned journey to the International Space Station. After its rollout to Space Launch Complex 40 at Cape Canaveral Air Force Station in Florida, the SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket was lifted into place for a static engine fire test simulating launch. The exercise ended with all 9 engines firing at full power for 2 seconds. The successful test clears the way for Falcon 9's upcoming demonstration flight to the ISS, as part of NASA's plan for private companies to take over cargo delivery to the orbiting complex.
We finished the 30-year incredible era of shuttle, but very excited about the upcoming launch of SpaceX. What that will do will be to show to the world that America is still the leader in space exploration. It'll provide for us American access to low Earth orbit for cargo initially, and then as we go through the rest of our competition, American access for crew members.
Expedition 31 Soyuz Commander Gennady Padalka, NASA Flight Engineer Joe Acaba, and Flight Engineer Sergei Revin participated in traditional ceremonies at the Gagarin Cosmonaut Training Center in Star City, Russia, outside of Moscow. The trio later departed for the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan to complete training for their launch to the International Space Station aboard their Soyuz spacecraft later this month. Acaba, Padalka, and Revin are scheduled to conduct a series of pre-launch activities over the next 2 weeks as they prepare for liftoff to the orbital outpost. NASA Deputy Administrator Lori Garver visited the NASA Shared Services Center at Stennis Space Center. The NSSC provides support to NASA in the areas of human resources, financial management, procurement, information technology, and business support services. Garver was briefed by senior leadership on the latest NSSC initiatives, including the now fully operational Enterprise Service Desk that supports employees agency-wide.
And thank you for calling the NASA Shared Services Center.
She also spoke with NSSC employees at an all-hands event.
Really enjoyed getting to know not only the management, but the whole team that works here to support us at NASA. The work that we're doing could not be done without the NSSC, and I'm just thrilled to be here for the awards program. I got to take a couple of calls, and I'm really happy that you guys have done such a great job supporting NASA.
For more info about the NSSC and its services, check out www.nsse.nasa.gov.
You've now made a very fine capsule.
NASA Chief Technologist Mason Peck visited the Ames Research Center, where he was briefed on projects in biology, nanotechnology, and telerobotics. Peck also visited Stadler Henke, a small software company in the Bay Area that's received more than 50 NASA Small Business Innovative Research Awards. CEO Dick Stotler briefed Peck about the unique artificial intelligence software systems the companies developed for NASA and other government agencies and private manufacturers while creating new jobs here in the U.S. The second annual USA Science and Engineering Festival, held at the Washington, D.C. Convention Center, featured more than 35 NASA-sponsored exhibits aimed at inspiring students to pursue careers in science, technology, engineering, and math. The country's only national science fair, the USA Science and Engineering Festival, was founded to celebrate scientists and engineers, much like film and music stars and professional athletes.
3, 2, 1, start.
Aspiring rocketeers showed off their gravity-defying skills at the NASA Student Launch Project's Flight Challenge. The annual event, organized by the Marshall Space Flight Center and sponsored by ATK Aerospace Group, provides teams of middle school through college students the opportunity to design, build, and test large-scale rockets. The teams vie to see whose rocket gets closest to the 1 mile-high altitude mark and safely returns its onboard science payload to Earth.
We're getting real-world experience here, what people can do after they graduate, just for aerospace engineering, mechanical engineering, electrical, science in general, and it's been a very tremendous help and realization to see what actual companies are doing in the real world after school.
We need engineers. We as a country need engineers. We as ATK need engineers. We as an aerospace industry need engineers. This is probably the best way I can think of to encourage them to join us.
High school teams from across the country presented their solutions to a variety of 21st century problems during the Conrad Foundation's 5th Annual Innovation Summit held at the Ames Research Center. The event included 15 finalist teams competing in the categories of aerospace exploration, clean energy, and health and nutrition. Each category's winning teams received cash prizes of $5,000 to continue development of their project. NASA astronaut Dottie Metcalf-Lindenberger will lead an international team of four aquanauts on the 16th NASA Extreme Environment Mission Operations, or NEMO, expedition next month off the coast of Key Largo, Florida. Nice. The 12-day mission at the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean will simulate a visit to an asteroid and test innovative solutions to challenges astronauts expect to face. Joining Metcalf-Lindenberger inside the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration's Aquarius Reef-based undersea habitat will be fellow astronauts Kamiya Yui of the Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency and Timothy Peake of the European Space Agency. Rounding out the crew is Steve Squires, the Cornell University astronomy professor and principal investigator of the Mars rovers Spirit and Opportunity. Squires was on the previous NEMO crew. The agency's website, nasa.gov, has won Webby Awards in two categories as the best in government. The site received its fourth consecutive People's Voice Award, its fifth overall, and for the first time, captured the annual competition's Judges Award. www.nasa.gov is one of the most visited government URLs, with consistently high customer satisfaction ratings comparable to popular commercial sites.
All three engines up and burning. 2, 1, 0, and lift off.
Its busiest day ever was July 8, 2011, when NASA TV coverage of the launch of STS-135, the final space shuttle mission, was watched by more than 560,000 people at nasa.gov. A Webby Award is the foremost honor recognizing the world's best websites. At the Johnson Space Center, the Westbrook Intermediate School Band, winners of the 2011 Texas State Band Contest, performed a special concert for JSC employees in the Teague Auditorium. The featured selection was a special piece commissioned by the band directors to commemorate the space shuttle program, entitled STS Mission, Echeta Teta.
Mission STS, which is the scientific distinction in the title, and Echeta Terra, which is the poetic. Now, Echeta Terra is derived from both the Italian and Latin languages to mean to exceed the Earth, so very fitting. Echeta coming from Latin aceto, which means to exceed, and terra, meaning earth.
A photo of the band in front of the full fuselage shuttle trainer at JSC was included in their concert program.
My name is Daphne Dador, and I'm a Legislative Affairs Specialist at NASA Headquarters. My office's mission is to handle all communications and relationships related to legislative issues between the agency and Congress. And so I do things like help out with preparing for congressional hearings, handling requests from members of Congress and their staff, as well as monitoring relevant legislation. I grew up in California. I was in the San Francisco Bay Area. You know, NASA Ames has always been a presence for me. When I was little, my grandparents would take myself and my brothers out to Moffett Field. I've always been attracted to coming to a place, you know, with a larger cause and a bigger idea. So Washington, D.C. to me was a place to do that. I had an undergraduate degree in politics, which is something that a lot of people in Washington, D.C. have. And so I decided I needed to specialize in an area. So I decided to go to graduate school. And I found the Space Policy Institute at George Washington University, and that's where I learned that there was this field called space policy and that I could be involved in it even though I wasn't a scientist or engineer. And at this agency, I think it represents the best about being an American. It's, you know, it's having an enterprising nature, it's advancing humanity and knowledge, and, you know, it's that American spirit. On the outside, I've always been proud of our space program, but now that I'm part of the agency, I feel that it's even more important for me when I go home or when I go out to talk about what we do and why it's so important to the nation.
51 years ago, on May 5th, 1961, Mercury astronaut Alan Shepard launched aboard his Freedom 7 spacecraft from Cape Canaveral's Launch Complex 5, making him the first American in space. His historic flight came 3 weeks after Russian cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin became the first human to do so. Shepard's suborbital flight reached an altitude of 116 miles and lasted about 15 minutes. After traveling just over 300 miles, Shepard and Freedom 7 splashed down safely in the Atlantic Ocean. 20 years ago, on May 7, 1992, Space Shuttle Endeavour launched from the Kennedy Space Center on its maiden voyage, STS-49.
3, 2, 1. Booster ignition and liftoff of the maiden voyage of Endeavour on a satellite rescue mission.
The 9-day mission included the first 3-person spacewalk, during which mission specialists Pierre Thuat, Richard Hebe, and Tom Akers retrieved and attached the crippled Intel 6 satellite to a new upper stage, then relaunched it to its intended geosynchronous orbit. Providing assistance inside Endeavour was Commander Dan Brandenstein, mission specialists Kathy Thornton and Bruce Melman, and pilot Kevin Chilton, a 2012 inductee of the Astronaut Hall of Fame. And that's This Week at NASA. For more on these and other stories, or to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and other social media, log on to the Webby Award-winning www.nasa.gov.